Each of these animations consists of a single layer in After Effects with just one effect. Interestingly, you can simulate basic physics with a lesser known effect that remains largely untapped. Today, we're diving into Particle Playground, an effect as ancient as After Effects itself. Most users avoid it because it's packed with sliders and options that seems to do nothing unless you want a tiny red fountain of square particles in the middle of your screen. But hey, let's turn that frown upside down. This effect can do so much more than what you see on screen. It has several particle emitters, and you can even work with text, which I'll demonstrate shortly, so stick around or use the chapter markers if you must. Now let's start with this AE logo shape layer that already has the particle playground effect from the simulation category. The first thing we'll do is what every client wants: make my logo bigger. Well, I think this logo is big enough. So we're going to do the next best thing, which is explode the logo. So I'll switch back the FX icon, and first I'll open the Canon options and I'll turn off the Canon. I'll return to it in a later stage. But for now, for the particles per second, I'll set it to 0. Then I'll head over to the layer exploder. I'll open it up, and for the explode layer, I'll reference the layer itself. So I'll tell it to use the AE logo, which brings it back on screen. Now, currently you can see the radius of new particles is set to 2. I'll change it to 3. And then I'll change the velocity dispersion to 300. Now, if I'll press spacebar and preview the animation, we can get a sense of what's happening. So too many particles. I'll go back to the beginning and I'll set a keyframe for the radius of new particles at the first frame. Then I'll move one frame forward by pressing page down, and I'll take this value to 0. And this means that after this point, if I'll preview again, no new particles are being generated. All right, already this looks interesting. Let's go back to the beginning and twirl down the gravity section, which of course controls the gravity. I'll turn on the gravity to 150, and then I'll tap to the next option, which is force random spread. Now you need to be very gentle with this, so I'll take it to 0.01. This should be enough to create some really random spread of all the particles. Feel free to play with those values and see what you can come up with. But now I'll return back to the beginning and I'm going to define a wall. So instead of these particles just falling down, I'm going to make them bounce or collide with a mask. And to do it again, I'll go back to the start. I'll select the layer. I'll click and hold on the rectangle tool and switch to the ellipse tool. And because I'm working with a shape layer, I need to change it from creating new shape to tool creates mask. And now I can hold down shift and double click on the ellipse tool, which is going to create this mask shape. Now, for some reason, it creates it over here. I'll double click on the mask shape and just move it to the middle of the frame. And then, of course, I can collapse everything here in the timeline, return back to the wall properties inside the particle playground effect, and set the wall to mask 1. And notice what happens now when I preview the effect. So those particles are going to bounce back of this and create this infinite vortex of particles. Now, what's more amazing is that we can actually enable motion blur for this effect, which supports it natively. Unbelievable for this old timer. And if we want, we can go back to the beginning and then in the layer exploder, change the radius of new particle to something even smaller. So maybe go with 2 if you want some more tiny bits of particles, just to show you how this looks. And of course, with motion blur, it looks even better. Now, just to make sense of this animation, I'll go again to the start. I'll select the layer. I'll duplicate another instance. From this instance, I'm going to take away the particle playground effect. And then I'm going to move 20 frames forward and trim this layer by pressing Option and right bracket. I'll start this one at 10 frames, so I'll drag it over here. And then for the upper copy, I'll hold down the Option key. This will be Alt and Shift on the Windows side and tap the letter T to create a keyframe and expose the opacity value. And then I'll move a few frames forward and change it to 0. So we can see the After Effects logo for a moment before it breaks up to all of those tiny pieces. At any given moment, we can return to the After Effects logo and play with the settings. For example, I'll change the gravity settings to 250. I'll go back to the start and preview the animation. And look at this. Isn't this cool? Especially considering how little time we've put into this. But we're only scratching the surface of what can be achieved with this effect. So I'll stop the preview. And here is another example. We are starting with a shape layer, the size of the comp, hiding, by the way, a purple background. Here it is. And you can also work with solid layers, but I have this compulsion to avoid them if I can. Anyway, back to the topic. I've named this shape Primary Physics, which will make sense soon. To save time, I'll copy the layer name to the clipboard. So I'll press Return and Command-C. And I will apply the particle playground effect. Then I'm going to go ahead and switch off the Canon for a moment. We'll return to it soon. Then I'll click Options. And over here, I can enter a Canon text as well as a grid text. So let's click on Edit Grid Text. And I'll paste the text that I've just copied. So primary and the second line will be physics. Now, you'll get the most out of this by using a mono-spaced font. Since we are going to use these letters inside the grid, if possible, try to use the same amount of characters for each line. This is why I've named it Primary Physics. I told you, it will make sense. So, in this case, I'm only going to create two lines, but you can go ahead and create as many as you like. I leave it over here as Use Grid Loop Text, but as suggested, I'll pick something which is monospaced. So I'll click on this font list, start to type the word dark, and this is the font that I'll use. Dark mode, mono, off. Then click OK, and then click OK again. Now, nothing is happening, because what we'll need is to format the grid. So I'll close the Canon settings, open up the grid options, and I'll start climbing up from the bottom. Let's set the font size to 100. And for the color, I'll use the eyedropper and pick the same color of my initial shape. We can't see anything yet because we need to tell the effect how many particles across and how many down. Again, this is the grid that we just set up. So 7 characters in my case, and then I'll tap down and set it to 2 lines. And now we should see something on screen, but as you can see, it's a bit sporadic, so we are not exactly seeing what we are expecting. And this is because we need to define the width and the height. So I'll click and hold to separate those letters, and I'll set it to 800. From experience, I know this should work, and the height should be 200. Now, although we defined 2 rows of particles down, we are only seeing the first one, so we actually need to add another one. And this is going to show us the second line. What we can do now is just press spacebar to preview what we've created. And because of how this effect is set, we are creating for each frame 7 particles across and 3 rows of particles down. So I don't think that we need so many. I'll go to the beginning, and then I'll create keyframes for the particles across and particles down. And then move to the next frame. Again, pressing page down will do the trick. And set it to 0 on both cases. And now if I'll preview the comp, we just have a single row, actually 2 rows of particles, and they are influenced by the gravity. All right, not too interesting, but we're going to make it much nicer by going to the gravity first, and then changing the force to something lower, 30 in this case. And I'm going to set the force random spread to 0.5. And just so they won't fall directly down, it's not so interesting, I'm going to take just 1 degree, so 179. This will make sense in a moment, because now this is going to look like this. We have a little bit of inertia, a jump, due to the fact that we have this force random spread, and the particles are going to go down. Some of them are going to climb up, but this is not what I want to do. What I want to do is actually use those two options here, the repel and wall. I'll start with the wall. We already saw how this works. So I'll select the layer. I'll return back to the rectangular tool. Make sure again, the wall needs to be a mask which is applied to the layer. So I need to change the tool to create masks and then double click to create a mask around this layer. This is it, just so you can see it. All right, I can switch it off. I can also collapse everything over here and define it as a wall. So the wall is now mask number one. I'll preview again the comp just so you can get a sense of how this looks. Now they're going to bounce out of this wall. Wonderful. But we can also use this repel option to repel the particles from each other. So I'll start by adding a force. Let's go with 2. And then we can change the force radius. So the bigger this number is, the more amount of pixels around each character are going to be taken under account. So let's try 40 and then return to the beginning of the comp and press spacebar and see how this works. So you can see that they are repeating themselves. And if you want more, you can change, of course, the force as well as the radius. But I think 40 works quite nice here. Now this looks great, chaotic and unexpected, as well as works in real time. And of course, fully customizable. As it plays, I can tweak the gravity values, for example, so I can make the gravity even bigger, which is going to influence the simulation, as well as change the force random spread and change the direction. And you can get a sense of how this looks. Maybe from the beginning, it will make more sense. So you can see the angle, the direction. If you want, you can open it up and you can play with it. You can have a lot of fun with these very basic but real-time simulations inside After Effects. I'll undo a few steps, returning to the values that I started with. And then I'll go ahead, I'll close all of these settings, as well as the grid, and open up the Canon settings. Because remember, we switched off the Canon earlier, but we can actually integrate it with these letters. So to do it, I'll click on Options, and then I'll click on Edit Canon Text. I'll type in lowercase o, and for the font, I'll select something which create a perfect circle. So I know the Psi font is one candidate that can do it, and I'll select a light style for it. Then I'll click OK, and OK again. Next, I'll change the font size to 50, as well as change the particles per second. Let's start with a value of 10. And then press spacebar, and you can see those tiny circles starting to pop up from the middle of the screen. Now, we can also control the barrel radius, which is the radius where the particles are being emitted from. So let's go with 50. And I think that 10 is maybe too much, so I'm going to stop emitting those circles maybe after 4 seconds. So I'll click on particles per second to create a keyframe at 4 seconds. Move one frame forward and reset it to 0, so no new particles are going to be emitted. And now those particles are going to be considered in the same simulation. I'll enable motion blur, of course. Go to the beginning and preview this in full screen. And this is just wild. Think of all the things you can achieve with just what I showed you. Now, here are a few comps I created for the live stream I'm hosting with my friend Adam Bennett every other week. More details in the description below and on the live tab of this channel. So using the same principles I've demonstrated, I managed to create some lovely simulations for the holding loop before the show starts. Now, to be honest, there are so many things I didn't cover with this insane effect. If you want to dig deeper, I highly recommend watching the full-length tutorial by Jack Bartlett at Jack in Motion, which goes into every single feature of Particle Playground. The link is under the like button. I must also mention that there are third-party tools for more advanced 2D simulations like Newton and Physim. If you want me to cover these, let me know in the comments below. But this is it for this one. I hope you find it useful, and if you did, you can thank me with your index finger by hitting like and subscribe. Thanks for sticking around until the end, and I will catch you in the next one. Now go ahead and simulate something cool.